twinkles the game.
Hello and welcome to Researching the Future. My name is Michaela Dickey. I have a master's in music and am working towards an artist diploma in opera and voice here at the Schulich School of Music. In this episode, we are researching the future of music. We start with a man who has, count them, 12 Grammys. Richard King is a sound recording engineer who has worked with musicians like Yo-Yo Ma and on films like Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon. He gives us an inside look on what we can expect to hear in the future.
As a recording engineer, I was at Sony Music for 17 years in New York, and after that I was freelance for a while before I came here to teach.
So cello's that side, and saxophone is on the other side.
My job as a recording engineer is basically to make things sound pretty so the producer doesn't get fired. I place the microphones at the recording session, I blend them together, I come up with a balance between the instruments. It's nice to have 12 Grammys on my CV, but it doesn't really affect the way I do my work. Sound recording today generally is so closely linked with video that everything we do we have to be concerned about how it matches with image. Because of the larger size screens, especially in cinemas, the new challenge now is presenting elevation and height in sound. So we're going up. That's basically where sound recording is going. This is Studio 22 in the basement of the new music building here at Schulich School. And we are exploring multi-channel surround sound mixing with height channels. So what's different here from your conventional surround sound system is that we start with this horizontal plane in the middle, adding a few more speakers than usual. Normally you'd have three in the front and two in the back, but we have a complete ring here. From there, we add an additional ring above for the height, the addition of height. A good example of how we incorporate the height channels is if you're mixing sound effects for film and you have a scene in the movie where it's raining. In the past, you'd be sitting with rain coming from all around you, which sounds like rain, but now we can have rain coming from above you as well, so it's much more real. You actually feel like you're getting wet in the cinema. Mixing music, we can spread out the elements so that there's less traffic, you know, in the front channels. For instance, in stereo, you have to pile up all the instruments together. So you lose clarity and it's hard to discern between the guitar or a bass, whereas with so many channels, we can give each element its own space. Right, so this is in the high channels. I put the amp up there and I've kept the actual microphones on the guitar down in the lower, the mid level. So again, I'm creating this giant sized guitar by using the high channels with it. So we're working with NHK in Japan, that's the national broadcaster in Japan. On this multi-channel system. The NHK standard 22.2 is 22 loudspeakers and two subwoofers, and this is their new standard for audio that goes with their ultra-high vision video standard, which is also being adopted in Europe. This eventually will hit North America, just like HDTV took an additional 20 years. It became a standard in Japan and Asia, and then 20 years later was adopted in North America. I think this will follow as well. It's just a matter of time. So we're here in the Spatial Audio Lab of Kermit, which is the Center for Interdisciplinary Research in Music, Media, and Technology. And what we're testing for is we are seeing how different acoustic treatments affect a sound recording engineer as they go about one of their daily tasks. So this room is very dead except for the floor. The only reflections really coming back to the listener from the sidewalls, which we have set up here on motors. So what we're testing for here is how well engineers can work under three different scenarios of acoustic treatment. This is an absorbing material that's full of Rockwool insulation covered with fabric. So it damps the sound down quite extravagantly. And in this iteration, we have what we call specular reflection. So this is about four coats of lacquer on a plywood board. So it's very reflective. This third surface is diffusion, so what we get is many reflections coming back to the listener at different times. I'm here with Brett Leonard, one of our PhD candidates, and he's our test subject for the day as we prepare for tomorrow's real testing. And so he's performing a very simple task, equalization, under different acoustic treatments. During the actual testing, we'll have a screen drop in a wall basically between the listener and the surfaces so that they're really only affected by ear as they do their testing.
Ultimately, what we aim to do is make recommendations to manufacturers for the best setup acoustically for the modern control room. We're looking at ways for engineers to work more efficiently and productively so that they can finish their product on time and to meet lower budgets.
There is some fascinating interdisciplinary research being done at the Montreal Neurological Institute. Robert Satori and his colleagues are using brain imaging scans to better understand how the brain changes as a result of playing a musical instrument. What they find could answer some very interesting questions.
The basic idea behind what we're trying to do is to use music in a global way to understand brain function.
I look at what happens in the brain when cello players are playing the cello, which is exciting to me because I am a cello player and a neuroscientist. Playing the cello inside of the MRI is definitely very different than playing the cello outside of the MRI. For starters, you have to be lying down, which is a non-standard position for a cellist to be in. There are also the constraints inherent in the instrument itself, being that it doesn't actually have a resonant body, so you don't get the vibration feedback that you're used to getting from your instrument. It's also equipped with gut strings, which are a very different feeling than the metal strings. They're much harder to get sound out of.
So in this experiment, for the first time, we're looking at how the brain of a highly trained musician, specifically a cellist, is working when they're playing their instrument. So this has never been done before. The reason we do that is because music engages most of the most complex aspects of human cognition. So it involves hearing and listening, it involves motor actions to produce sounds, it involves memory, it involves emotion, it involves attention, it involves learning. So something like playing a musical instrument is a remarkable achievement that humans have.
The question of MRI is that it's a very specific environment. It's an environment that has several constraints and mostly magnetic constraints. Our main challenge here was to create instruments that have materials that are non-magnetizable. So we had to rethink all these electronics and all these sensors.
So this is the first real cello prototype that anybody's developed in the world. We've been working on this for about 5 or 6 years.
So we went for optics. So most of everything we do is using light to sense position of fingers, to sense positions of keys, to sense, for instance, a position of a bow in space. So we had to design instruments, and this includes the electronics. So we had to design instruments that bypass or that don't use such materials, but also that don't have electronic circuits.
Now, as a matter of fact, we won the best student paper award in an international electrical and computer engineering conference for best paper for this project.
So there's a system that controls the muscles of your hands, and there's a system that receives information from the ears. What we're really interested in is how those two systems work together. If there's a mistuning, you are going to move your finger to get the correct sound, right? And so we can look at that because our cello has these sensors that allow us to determine where the fingers are placed. So we can look at how the finger is moving, and then we can see in our brain images what brain regions are becoming active at the moment that you have to produce the adjustment. So here we're looking through the upper part of the brain like that, and you see these orange squiggles. Those represent the motor parts of the brain that control the hand. The colored areas represent areas where there's more oxygen uptake during a particular time point.
It's been known for a long time that music and learning to play music can help a great deal with various therapies, including rehabilitative therapy after stroke. Imagine, for instance, that you lost the ability to do something like that, right? Which is a task that is very simple for you and me, but potentially if you'd had a stroke, that would be a very difficult thing. La, 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 la. So, if you lost the ability to have that abstract spatial representation, you could retrain them to have this auditory association, and then that would help so that they would have something concrete to latch onto in order to relearn this skill, and that would translate into their everyday life.
You know, when you watch or listen to an expert musician, it's amazing to see what they do, right? It's the ability that they have, the control they have over their instrument is something that everyone always finds remarkable. So we want to understand, well, what makes that particular individual so good? What's going on in their brain that makes them so good compared to someone who maybe isn't quite so skilled? We don't really understand how the brain changes when we learn something. If we could unlock that mystery, it would have remarkable applications to everything from educating children to rehabilitating patients who've had a stroke, for example.
Learning to play an instrument is not easy. But for wind instruments, there's the added challenge of learning to breathe correctly in order to get the best sound out of the instrument, not unlike singing. But surprisingly, not much research has been done on musical breathing techniques. Isabelle Cossette is out to change that.
We're kind of respiratory athletes. The wind instrumentalists are really respiratory athletes. I started playing flute around 16 years old, and while I was studying, first the different teachers told me different things about breathing. Things like, you know, push with your diaphragm, do this, put the air at the bottom of your lungs, and things like that. I was really confused. So I decided to go and look into books to find out about, you know, how does it work, this respiratory system. And this was not aligned to what the teachers were telling me, so I was even more confused.
Okay, soft, jusqu'au bout, garde définie to relax.
There has been a lot of research on the respiratory system, but not while music playing.
Yes, cette phrase, celle-là, ça.
So the need was really triggered when I started teaching. So that led me to go and do a doctorate at the Université de Montréal. And I was introduced to Peter Macklem, who became one of my mentors. Peter Macklem was one of the most renowned respiratory physiologists in the world. And I was trained at the Meekins Christie Laboratory here at McGill to do research on respiratory mechanics. If we understand better how the body is involved, it's very useful to make a lot of progress at a much faster pace than, you know, just trying out things up in the air. So what we're doing here, we're using a motion capture system, which when it's used for respiratory mechanics, it's called optoelectronic plethysmograph. So it consists of 9 infrared cameras, and we put reflective markers on the thorax of the player. The infrared cameras film those, and we reconstruct in 3 dimension the chest wall displacement. That allows us to have information about the volumes of air used during performance. So we also measure the electric activation of the respiratory muscles, or the main respiratory muscles, with electromyography, so surface EMGs. That allows us to be able to describe what are the respiratory patterns that people are using while performing. We also measure mouth pressure, that is a respiratory parameter. In addition, we also started looking at the lips parameters. So we would look at the opening of the lips. That would give us some information about the flow of air and the velocity of air that is used when performing, and also about the distance of the lips from the edge of the flute. When you understand better all the parameters that are involved and how they are correlated and how they influence each other, well, you can better like control them. And in fact, what we found out in our studies is that we are using differently our respiratory system. So there's not one way that it can be taught for everyone. That really goes against the belief that, you know, there's only one way to breathe properly. It has to be kind of tailored to the body and to the needs of musical tasks, but also the body of each performer. All those findings are the first steps into developing new strategies to teach breathing to musicians, because if we don't understand the breathing they're using, we can't really teach it very efficiently. My goal is to clarify and demystify some concepts that are going around and that are maybe not very accurate.
The digital revolution has had a profound impact on communities where music used to be the glue that held everything together. PhD candidate Laura Risk, herself an acclaimed fiddler, takes us to a small town in the Gaspé. With Laura's help, the people of Douglastown are working to preserve their musical heritage.
In a lot of communities in Quebec, as elsewhere, traditional music is the music that holds the community together. My research focuses on traditional music in Quebec, what you might call folk music. Douglastown was historically an Anglophone community, although there was a small Francophone population as well. And like many villages in the Gaspé, in the second half of the 20th century, with the decline of the fishing and the lumber and the mining industries, there was a lot of out-migration. A lot of the culture of the village, which had been based around music and dance to a large extent, was shifting, and that somehow had not gotten transmitted to the next generation. There was a sense, I think, in the community that if they didn't document what the culture had been in the village, in 20 years, there wouldn't be anybody left to document it. But that maybe in documenting it, there would be a resurgence of interest.
This is very, very delicate, so I'm trying my best not to break it.
This tape, I think, is 1968. All of his tapes were in late 60s, possibly the early 70s. I think when we listen to these recordings from Douglastown and talk to people in the community, we can see how music is something that can hold a community together. Yeah, this is a kitchen party. They're doing the dance, and Bernard's calling the dance.
Nice.
In Douglastown, this music was popular in the sense that it was everywhere. It was played at house parties, and house parties were often in people's kitchens. They would take all the chairs and the table outside and put them outside, and then they would have a dance in the kitchen, and they would sing. They would each have their individual song that they were known for singing, and others might join in on the chorus.
She sailed far away o'er the dark rolling foam. Far away from the hills.
You also see some of the traditional divisions in society being crossed by the music. So, of course, in Quebec, there's a lot of issues around language, and Douglastown was primarily an Anglophone community. And in the music, you see Francophones and Anglophones both playing the same repertoire, knowing each other through music making, and friendships forming through music making. Music enabled that sort of coming together. There's two of us co-producing the CD, myself and Glenn Patterson, who's a PhD student at Memorial University in Newfoundland. So the CD includes quite a diverse repertoire. We really tried to paint a picture of musical life in Douglastown.
The project was initiated by the Community Center 4 years ago. Laura and Glenn generously spent hundreds of hours pursuing research, doing other interviews, selecting and describing the music for the CD. Douglastown is doubly privileged to have them as friends.
It's through these interviews that future generations can come to appreciate the richness of the music experienced here.
Today you see lots of people walking around with their headphones on, listening to music, and music has become something that we consume and less of something that we make within a community. Music is a particularly effective, strong, meaningful way of building community and maintaining community. And if we don't have community in our life, then we don't have very much, do we? Traditional music is much more about getting involved, and I love that.
Have you ever wanted to be in the spotlight or play a musical instrument but felt it was too late? It's not. Check out the New Horizons band. Its band members have taken up the challenge and are loving it.
I just retired and had lots of things to do, but when I met with my friend, I said I could see that at some point it would be good to have something where there's regular people contact, not something that you have to call up somebody and organize lunch, organize doing something, but something that happened on a regular basis. And he said, well, I have just the thing for you, and told me about the band.
I started working on this project about how to do a PhD studying music education for seniors. And in the book review I did, it was talking about New Horizons, so the international association. And I decided to start a band to study the population in the concert band.
I had never played an instrument before. I had never learned how to read music before. And to have that sense of accomplishment and of really learning something totally new and different has been really great. Really fun.
So I was interested in the psychological aspect, so I decided to use some questionnaires. This is great to assess quality of life, anxiety, depression. But for physiological measures, it requires different instruments. So we really have to do blood pressure tests, and also for the breathing capacity, I use spirometry tests. I'm studying the impact of music, but also comparing it with a group of people that do not participate in the band. What I expect to find is obviously an increase in psychological health. So a decrease in anxiety and depression, an increase in quality of life and well-being.
I can almost feel my brain working sometimes. And that's a quality of life thing, I think, is to really feel that you're learning something and something totally new.
Because it's sort of a physical instrument, really, I find it actually will, I mean, bit like going for a walk. It wakes me up after I play it. It exhilarates me to a certain degree.
What I've found in research is basically a huge difference on well-being, quality of life, and anxiety level, and also on depression.
Sometimes it is hard. Sometimes it just doesn't work. You know, you try to make a sound and it doesn't happen.
It's the expectations that are getting in the way sometimes. People are professionals or were professionals before retirement, so they are used to being good at what they do. So now put them in a totally different context and they have to learn from the very beginning, and it can be really frustrating, and they have self-doubts. So we have to soothe them and tell them it's normal. So the students in music education, they come in the band, they play, they sit in the ensemble, and they help out during the breaks or when people have questions, they show the fingerings and things like that. This is a really important part as well of my research, is to study the social interaction and between generations. So that's why we wanted it to be intergenerational.
So, are you ready for your first concert?
Thank you.
it's really special to do something together, I find. And I think maybe that's part of the charm of music. It's a very neat feeling.
Being in a band now means that she's trying something new and different, and it's kind of cool to see your mom always like pushing her limits and trying new things.
Oh, it's fantastic. I'm having a really good time.
Gives me something to look forward to.
There's not one day that I don't tell to myself that was a great idea. It's so nice to see people learning music and be so happy to play three notes or more and to play a piece and to see them grow. This is just amazing.
Well, that's our show on researching the future of music. We hope you've learned some new things about the many ways that music enriches our lives. I'm Michaela Dickey. Thanks for joining us.